What's good, DMV? Your girl Jackie Page here, and you are tuned into another episode of Girl Talk Live. Today, we're going to talk about accessing women's health services in Prince George's County because women in the county for a very long time have complained about the lack of available health care and the health care that is available and provided. So we are going to start this conversation today so that we can, one, figure out what healthcare is available and how we can access that. I cannot have this conversation by myself. So today, joining me, I have Dr. Stacy E. Little, who is the Vice President of Women's and Infants Services and Community and Population Health at the University of Maryland Medical Systems, UM Capital Region Health. Dr. Stacy Little, how are you doing today?
I am well and so excited to share with women of Prince George's County what we have going on over here in Largo, and not just in Largo, but in Laurel and in Bowie and the National Harbor and Suitland. So we really have a service that we can't wait to just tell everybody about. So I'm looking forward to this conversation.
And we're excited to hear what you guys have to offer. Like I mentioned earlier, women throughout Prince George's County for a very long time have complained about the healthcare services that are available not only to them, but to their kids. Mm-hmm. And it's time for us to start doing something about it. So let's go ahead and get into this. Dr. Little, tell me about some of the challenges that we as Black women that we face when it comes to our reproductive health and health in general in Prince George's County.
Well, Prince George's County, unfortunately, bears the brunt of most chronic diseases in the state in terms of individuals who reside here. We have a lot of people who suffer with hypertension as well as diabetes. And these two diseases in particular can compromise your overall health during pregnancy. If you come to pregnancy with these diseases or develop these diseases during the gestational period of pregnancy. Also, we have a lot of obesity in this county, which also puts women at risk during, when you're planning pregnancies. So really what we want to help women do in this county so as to be able to have healthier mommies and healthier babies. We want women to think about pregnancy prior to pregnancy. I know that sounds like nobody does that. And that's like, what are you talking about, crazy lady? Yeah. But really, it really does help women have their best health prior to pregnancy. So, making sure you're watching your nutrition and your weight and, making sure that you're having these conversations with your primary care provider. And if you're on medications or if you're doing certain activities that aren't really conducive to you getting pregnant, or maybe you have fibroids and you need to address those things first, or whatever it is, we want you to do those things first and then plan your pregnancy in partnership with your provider and your partner, that when you have your baby, and for a lot of women, pregnancy is something that is not going to happen multiple times in their life. Mm-hmm. A lot of women are choosing to have babies later in life. They are focusing on career and education. And so this baby may be their only baby or their, two at the most. Right. And so we want these pregnancies to be awesome from the moment of conception to the moment you deliver your baby, you take your baby home. And the way we can do that as a partnership with our patients is looking and considering the health of that mom before she becomes mom. And then throughout her pregnancy, monitoring and making sure women get into prenatal care very early in their pregnancy. And then following that mom throughout, not just the third trimester, but yes, the fourth trimester, and that's your postpartum. And that's very important. Women, during the pregnancy, everybody's thinking about the baby. But then after the baby, we need to focus on that baby and that mommy. The mommy mommy is important. We got to keep her healthy throughout the pregnancy and in the fourth trimester as well, and make sure that baby and that mom are doing well after pregnancy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Definitely can't negate you on anything you just said. Once the baby is here, mommy has to take care of the baby. So we have to make sure that the baby and mommy are both well taken care of. Since we're on the topic of, you know, babies and pregnancy, why does Prince George's County have a higher incidence of fetal mortality than neighboring counties?
Yeah. So in Prince George's County, again, it really takes us back to our community health. You know, individuals in this county bearing the brunt of a chronic disease, quite frankly, when you compare us to other counties. That along with individuals who may be lower income and maybe uninsured. We have a large uninsured population here in Prince George's County. And even with our very robust and generous Medicaid system that we have here in the state of Maryland, we still have individuals who aren't eligible because they may be new immigrants or they are documented and they don't have the ability to access healthcare. We here at UMCAP Region, we serve that population, particularly women and children. So we have a mama, and we call it the mama and baby bus. Mm-hmm. But the bus really is a mobile health unit that serves women on a van, and where we have retrofitted with exam rooms, et cetera. So it functions very similar to like a community clinic. It's just on wheels. And so we serve women who otherwise would not have access to healthcare so that we can follow those individuals throughout their pregnancy. And they don't, you know, because the opposite of not providing healthcare to these women is that they show up to your emergency rooms without ever having had prenatal care, oftentimes having chronic diseases that have impacted the fetal development of their babies and also compromised their own health. And so what we end up having is the sickest of the sickest women coming into the hospital because they weren't able to access health care, which is so critical. So it's a combination of many factors, access to insurance and healthcare, the fact that many women start their pregnancy journey already with some health needs that have not been addressed, us really needing to focus as a community around preconception care and what that really looks at. I know people think, well, most people don't plan a pregnancy, but you can plan pregnancies and they can be, you know, a part of your life journey. And you can think about how you want to integrate them into your life so that you can have the best outcomes. And that's really what we strive for here with our providers is having those very frank, honest, and open conversations with women as they plan their life, you know, from early in their adulthood through their mid-year. And then, you know, even women, you know, transitioning into menopause. And, you know, we have women who have babies as they're transitioning out. And now you have another baby 7 years after you thought you never want to have a baby again. So we want to be there for women throughout their life course and their life journey around their reproduction so that the journey is one that is really led by them.
Yeah.
You know, absolutely. Things aren't just happening to you. Mm-hmm. You are orchestrating your
plan around it. Mm-hmm. You know, you've been talking about the lack of care for women and then their kids. What are some things that we can do about this? Because there are, you know, from what you're saying, there are resources available. What can we do to combat these high numbers of women who don't have care and infant mortality? What are things that we can do to stop this?
Well, you know, as a system, as I said, we are providing care. We do it as a community benefit. We have partnerships with the March of Dimes and other organizations that support this effort, but it in no way really supports the full cost of providing healthcare. We have grown our mama and baby bus exponentially over the last 5 years. It started out with less than 100 patients. Now, during COVID, we served within 6 months, really, we started serving people probably about January of this year, because COVID kind of really shut us down. But in the last 6 months, we've served the number of people we served the entire year last year. So the number of women that have needed these services have grown. Right now, we've served over 400 women in 6 months. This is, you know, so, and we don't turn you away. We just, you know, we try to find a way to continue to provide services to you, because we know if we don't provide services to these women, we will see sicker women coming to our hospital, you know, just, and then that's just a, that's an injustice. That's an equity issue.
Yeah.
And so we're very, very astutely aware, and you know, that is an issue here in this county. And one of the things that we're also doing in partnership with the March of Dimes is something called supportive pregnancy care. And really what that is an opportunity for women who are most at risk because of previous or, you know, pre-health issues, social determinants, variety of factors that may put them at risk during their pregnancy. We bring them together as a group and we provide prenatal care to them in a group, and they get to connect with the midwife that leads that group. And we talk about low intervention care. We partner with doula services. We're thinking about all the ways to ensure that women feel comfortable during their pregnancy and have access to these very viable services that are needed to support them throughout their journey. And this is for a woman who may be having on the third baby or fourth baby. So it doesn't matter where you are with your life cycle in terms of your reproduction. If it's your first baby or your last baby, we want to make sure that you're connected to this kind of care. So we find, you know, we have found that supportive pregnancy care, some people also refer to it as centering, is very, very, very successful with women who are high risk or women who are younger, younger adult women, or women who, you know, do better in more of a kind of a group setting, getting prenatal care than individual. So what we try to do is offer a variety of ways in which you can engage in your health care that makes best sense for you. And we offer supportive pregnancy care in English and in Spanish. Right now, we actually have a Spanish cohort going on.
Oh, okay, good. There are a lot of women who have been leaving the county to deliver their babies, and then they're coming back. The services are here. Why are women leaving the county and coming back when the services are available right here?
Well, let's be frank. Let's be honest, right? We had a hospital for many years that was not on par.
Okay.
What our county residents deserve. Mm-hmm. And now we have a state of the art facility that has providers who are exemplary, experts in their field, specialists. So we have the ability to really serve, and particularly in OBGYN and Women's Health Services, to be able to provide these services to women so that they don't have to drive to the District of Columbia and be in a 45-minute traffic jam only going 15 miles, you know, or having to go to other counties. You can stay in your own county and get access to phenomenal care. We have expanded our women's health services with the women whom we serve in mind, in thinking about Prince George's County women. What are the needs of our residents? So we brought on a urogynecologist who was in a different county. I won't say which county, but we have brought her on and she is phenomenal. We've brought on specialists in fibroid treatment and gynecological surgeries, because we know Black women disproportionately are impacted by fibroids, and you should be able to get care in your own county, right? We have gyn-oncologists that we have partnerships with so that we can address these issues that a lot of women have neglected. You know, I have women in my sister friend circle who believe incontinence is normal for a woman of a certain age. But I can tell you that our urogynecologist is like, come see me. I will help you, you know, kind of get your swag back, because we can address these issues, but you have to get to a provider. You have to kind of get out of your own way to make sure you get the services that you need, because we have them here at this facility and in this health system.
Yeah.
And we're here, we're listening. And the other thing that I want your listeners to know is that we are listening to the county. You know, we're in strong partnership with the county health department, and they do community assessments, very deep dive community assessments. And then we also go out in the community and we listen to our residents and we look at the data that is driving the health needs that we see in our county. And the way in which we have designed our programs is to be responsive of that need. And we want to hear from you. We want to hear what else do you need? You know, what else can we do? Another thing that we have looked at and we are in the process of developing is how we integrate hypertension prevention and management, because again, this is a huge issue, particularly for women of color. During pregnancy, developing hypertensive issues during gestation, and then also post. But, you know, we want to make sure that your postpartum, you get connected to a cardiologist who can help you with prevention of developing heart disease. You know, maybe we can delay that for later in your life. So sometimes it's not that we're going to prevent it all together, but maybe we can prevent some of the onset of these very, very impactful diseases that prevent you from having the best life you want.
Yeah, no, that makes a lot of sense. We seem to have a lot of high-risk pregnancies in the community, but it's not really clear exactly what that means. So can you give us a little more details on what exactly constitutes a high-risk pregnancy?
Sure. So a couple of things. One is coming into prenatal care late. One of the challenges that we've had historically prior to being UMCAP region is that we had a lot of patients who come into prenatal care within the third trimester. That is a problem. And that's driven by many things. Again, that's driven by, I don't have enough daycare for my children. I can't take off of my job because I am a day laborer. I'm an hourly wage worker and I don't have benefits. Whatever it might be will prevent women from moving forward in trying to get care. Another issue is developing these chronic diseases, or, you know, already having the chronic disease, right? So we talked about that. Diabetes and hypertension are huge. We serve about 60% of our patients have some kind of chronic disease whom we serve, and about, that's just one. You know, they have one chronic disease. And then we have about 20% more that have at least two or more. So, you know, we have individuals who really are struggling with their own health journey, but while they're struggling with their health journey, they got pregnant, you know, and because they're living life and they're loving whom they love, and life happens. And we understand that. We just want to make sure that when you know you're pregnant, or if you think you might be pregnant, come get that pregnancy test and let's get you into care as soon as possible. And don't let lack of health care be the barrier. Okay. Don't let that be the barrier, because we're going to help you figure it out. We're going to get you on our bus. We're going to get you some health care. Okay. Because we want you and that baby that you are nurturing during this gestational time to be as healthy as that you can be, you know, during and afterwards is so critical.
Yeah. Now you mentioned, you know, the earlier the better, but if somebody's watching or they're listening right now and they're like, hey, you know, I may be in my second or my third trimester, I may even be post-pregnancy. Can I still come in and get that prenatal care or that postnatal care? Can they still come in and get that care?
Absolutely.
And we're not gonna turn you away.
One of the things we're not gonna turn you away. So, you know, like you said, if you're looking for care, you know you didn't get into care early, we're gonna still take care of you. Okay. But we're, you know, and our doctors, we're probably going to connect you with a specialist, perhaps, particularly if you come in with some of these, chronic diseases or gestational diseases that I've referred to during our conversation. And we're definitely going to get you connected to one of our specialists to make sure that you're okay and the baby's okay. And then what we're going to do, so let's say you're coming in and I'm glad you mentioned postpartum. I mean, some people might have said, why do I need to go to a doctor? I already have my baby. One of the things that we know is that postpartum depression is real.
It's real. It's important.
It's a very real thing. And a lot of women ignore the depression that they experience. They brush it off as hormonal, or maybe this is the way I'm supposed to feel. I'm not really sure. Or, you know, maybe you live in a community or you live in a household where people aren't very open to discuss with you your mental health needs. I absolutely reach out, get your appointment, talk about your needs. One of the things that we had, I haven't started it back up again, but we stopped it during the pandemic, but we have a postpartum support group here that I will be reviving again. And was very successful in women just talking about, not about necessarily mental health, but just being a mom,
Yes,
you just need to talk about being a mom and having a new baby and just some of the stressors of that and having a safe place to talk about that and not feeling like a failure.
Yeah.
You know, sometimes, you know, you don't want to tell people that you're feeling some kind of way because then they're like, well, what's wrong with you? You're not happy with your baby, you know, and it's not always about that. It's just, sometimes you just need to check in around your feelings and why you might be feeling the way you feel, getting permission even to
find that.
To feel your feelings. Just embrace your feelings. It's okay. And then also giving yourself permission. As women, give yourself permission to find time for you.
Yes, especially after having a child.
It's been all about that baby.
Yeah.
For 10 months.
Yeah. And it will continue to be about the baby. A lot of nurturing that you have to do. So you're mm-hmm. right. Taking that time for yourself and checking in with yourself, but then also having others check in on you. I think that's really important. That piece that sometimes I think we as Black women kind of just miss in general is we don't allow people to check in on us. And that plays a big role. And, you know, when you have that baby that's just come into this world, it's a new life, new routines, those type of things are important. They're super important.
Absolutely. And we have to give ourselves permission because I think women, you know, Black women, women of color in general, you know, there's this expectation that somehow there's some like a switch that turns on that you're supposed to experience once you have a baby and you're supposed to know all the things that you're supposed to do. But it doesn't really work like that. So, you know, we have supportive services in this county, actually, specifically just for Prince George's County residents. And it has absolutely nothing to do with your income, nothing to do with us feeling like you need help. It's about, look, we have help. Do you want this free help? Because it's available to you. And what the county offers, free, it's free. Completely free. And what you get is lactation consultant. You get a nurse for 3 visits. You get a clinical social worker to assess and help you with any emotional needs you might have. And then if there are additional needs beyond that, we connect you to services. You know, so we have Healthy Beginnings, Bright Beginnings. We have these services available for women in our county because, you know, our health officers and our director of health and human services and our executive leadership in this county wants healthy mommies and healthy babies. And this system does too. So we all work collaboratively to ensure that happens. And I can tell you that, you know, all of the women who deliver here are eligible for what's called Family Connects is the program that we have here, which is actually a science-based program, and it's proven to be effective, you know, and so it's here, and we have it in this county, and the community has embraced it so well, if you deliver here, we offer it to you. It's completely voluntary. You can say, no, I don't want those folks in my house. But then some people are like, yeah, I need that. I would love to have that. You know, let me have a nurse come to my house to help me with this baby for a couple of times, you know, before I'm off with the training wheels by myself, you know, and that kind of thing. So it's amazing what we have in this county. And most people just aren't aware of it. You know, yeah. they don't realize just the breadth of capacity and service and passion that public health professionals and the health system has for its residents. Mm-hmm. And I hope that we can, in time, and I understand people's concerns and histories and trusts, you know, and trust is something you build with people when they have good experiences. You know what I mean? And they can trust they're going to have good experiences.
Yeah.
And I hope that people give us a chance to earn their trust and to allow us to give them good experiences.
Yeah, most definitely. Mm-hmm. You mentioned a few seconds ago that you do have lactating services. Mm-hmm. Breastfeeding has been a big thing. There's been a really big emphasis on that over the last few years. Mm-hmm. Is it really that important? Is it really something that new mothers should consider doing?
Absolutely. If you can, I don't want to shame any mommies. If you can't do it for whatever reason, you know, we will support you in that too. But if you can breastfeed your baby, it is so critically important, you know, because you give your baby immunity through your breast milk. I know a lot of women get concerned about the colostrum not being enough. But trust me, you're enough. You know, your body is engineered to breastfeed if you can. Some people do have challenges, and I don't want people to feel like, oh, I'm ashamed because I can't breastfeed my baby. But also, you know, we know that babies who breastfed have less illness because of the fact that you're giving your baby
immune. Yeah.
And then also you for those women who are worried about the snapback, which I know a lot of these young ladies are, when you breastfeed, you burn far more calories. You're like a calorie burning machine. So if you rigorously breastfeed, now you can't be faking it now.
Yeah.
You gotta be real.
Let it flow.
And you know, you eat 3, 4, 5 times a day. You gotta pump or breastfeed your baby the same, you know. So you have to rigorously breastfeed. But if you do, you'll be surprised how, you know, your body is meant to just kind of, you know, go back. And it also helps to cause contractions in your uterus. Yep. Mm-hmm. You'll feel that during your breastfeeding. And so it really helps your body to go back, you know, helps with lots of things that are happening to you postpartumly. So we strongly encourage it for the mommy benefits and the baby benefits.
Yeah, I have two best friends that recently had baby girls, and both of them have been breastfeeding, and they have like raved about it. Not only from the standpoint of like their body and, you know, what it does for the baby, but just also the connection.
Attachment. Absolutely. So let's talk about that. So sometimes when mommies are breastfeeding, we have to make sure we find ways for the daddy to do it, to attach to,
yeah.
You know, because sometimes daddies will get jealous of the baby.
It's real.
You know, so we have to make them feel like they're a part of what's happening postpartumly and the baby's care. And so when you can pump and have a bottle and use nipples that are most like a woman's nipple, you know, anatomy. And that way that baby can attach with the daddy as well, you know, but babies begin to, you know, they learn, they smell, they know which one has the milk. Because they can smell it. But you know, it's a great way to make sure both partners are connecting with the baby during feeding time and that kind of thing. But yes, you know, breastfeeding your baby is a great way to attach to your baby. And also, you know, eye cues as they get older and the cooing and the smiling and the, you know.
Yeah, both of them have just like, oh my gosh, it's been the best experience ever. They did say starting off, you know, it was something they used to. It was a little rough, but once they got into it, it was actually something that they really, really, really enjoyed. So I love that you said that you guys have, a lactating specialist there to help with that process. Yeah. Because like I said, I've heard a lot of great things about breastfeeding for mommy as well as for baby.
Absolutely. And, you know, we also work with doulas. We also work with doulas. So doulas are a good alternative, you know, to outside of the hospital and during your pregnancy, because what they can do is help you with the lactation and the preparation for having a baby in, you know, and we partner with them. They work a lot with our midwives. We have a breastfeeding coalition here that I started a couple of years ago, and it is really made up of nothing but lactation consultants and doulas and nurses, you know, people who are really strong advocates for breastfeeding. So we know we have a problem here in Prince George's County with young women wanting to breastfeed, partly because, you know, I did a study here a couple years ago, and many of them talked about not having anybody in their life who ever breastfed.
Wow.
Right. They're, you know, younger women. Yeah. So they haven't seen models of women breastfeeding. So we have to, as women in our, you know, sister circles, we have to encourage people to breastfeed, because there may not be examples of it in your own family.
And one thing that I am noticing now that you say that, I feel like it can be a taboo type of thing to talk about in the Black family. Mm-hmm. So that's just, you know, something else to point out that, you know, it may, you know, mommy may have done it, but you may have never known because she just doesn't want to talk about it, or it was something that happened for a very short period of time. So, I love that there's a huge emphasis on it, and it's something that we as Black women were talking about, and that you are making sure that you put a big emphasis on, because it is so, so, so important. Like I said, not only for mommy, but also for baby. It's something that is definitely important. You and Capital just opened a new hospital in Largo. Yeah. Can you give us some details on how you are addressing women's needs in this new medical facility?
Well, as I said earlier, we have really broadened the capacity of our women's health service to include not just OBGYN and maternal fetal medicine specialists, which are critical, particularly in this county, making sure that we have specialists who can address high-risk moms. But we also have a urogynecologist now that can address issues of incontinence and prolapse, uteruses, and things that people don't really think about or maybe want to talk about. We have specialists that manage fibroids, menopausal management, thinking about how we, you know, transition as women. And a lot of it, we suffer in silence and we don't talk about a lot of the symptoms that we have, but we have specialists who can address that. We also recently brought on a breast surgeon and a breast doctor who can address the breast cancer needs that we have here, because actually we do have significant number of Black women in this county and just nationally, you know, they may have breast cancer, but they enter sometimes late into care and then may have a more, what's the word I'm looking for? Negative outcome. Yeah. Yeah. But so we're looking to get ahead of that here through partnerships and through having providers who can really address the needs of women who may find a lump and need further exploration and investigation around their health need around that. So, and then we also have, as I said, we have a midwifery team. We have 7 midwives. People are always floored when they find out we have midwives.
Like, 7.
Yes, we have midwives.
You said 7.
Yes, we have midwives who are awesome. and who lead our mom and baby bus. They lead our supportive pregnancy program. We do have a tub at the new hospital. So if you want to have, yes, if you want to have utilize the tub to assist you in your low intervention birth, you know, because there are some techniques you can use to help you to get comfortable and to manage your pain without medication. And the midwives are experts in that, and they will assist you in that. And then the good news, though, I always tell people, you know, say, well, would you all send your midwives out to deliver babies at you know, at different folks' homes? I said, no, we don't. they deliver your baby right here in the hospital. But the good news is, you know, if it's a low intervention birth that you want, you really want something that's very, very, you know, hands-on with your partner and more less invasive of you know, kind of a medical intervention, you can have that. But if something happens,
there's a system, there's a support. We are ready to
move that to the next level quick. You don't have to worry about getting in an ambulance, getting in your car, or trying to come to a place to address that. You get that addressed right then and there. We move you from low to high, and that's how that works. But we are very respectful of women and their choices and whom and how, whom they want in the room and how they want to deliver their babies. And we try as hard as we can to accommodate. Until we, you know, unless you have something going on and we have to break the news to you that we know you wanted a low intervention birth, but that's not going to work this time.
You have to pivot real quick.
Right, exactly.
You know, a support system is what I'm hearing, not only for like, you know, in my years of pregnancy, but before I get pregnant, after I get pregnant, through menopause is really what I'm hearing you guys are offering at this new location, which is great. Because again, you know, a lot of us doing better as women is knowing what's available to us and knowing that, hey, it just doesn't start when I turn 45. Like, no, you can come in when you're 25. You can come in when you're 18, when you're, you know, 55 and 60 to get the services that you need all throughout your life. Like you said, you have to start at it early. You can't wait until the last minute. So just love hearing that you have all this phenomenal stuff at the new location. You are also responsible for community and population health. Tell me about some of the initiatives that you are leading to help women of Prince George's County lead healthier lives.
Okay, so through our community health team, we have something called diabetes prevention. So what we're trying to do is engage people early before they become diabetic. They do have to have some what we call precursors or some markers that indicate that they may be moving toward diabetes. Then they're eligible for this program. And so we have most often, unfortunately, men tend not to get into these programs, but women get in. And we've been very, very successful with our DPP program. A lot of women lose weight, a lot more weight than they thought they would. Also, they develop new nutritional habits, exercise habits, all those things that help support their weight loss. And then also it's a journey with peers. So you develop a network of friends who assist you in the moment when you're in the class, but then also out of class, you can develop those relationships. So we have the DPP program. We also have lifestyle programs, which focus on nutrition, getting active, healthy lifestyle that we offer in Prince George's County. Right now, everything is remote, but prior to COVID, we really were out there in the community. And then we also offer for free services called, it's a training program called Mental Health First Aid, and it helps people develop kind of first responder skill sets on how to identify and assist individuals with mental health needs into getting into care. And which is really critical and has been really critical during this time of the pandemic, where we're seeing a lot of people, you know, really feeling a lot of anxiety, which may have been brought on because of isolation or other, you know, other circumstances that were exacerbated by the pandemic. And so mental health needs within our county is something that we also focus on through our community health team. And then as it relates to population health, we focus more around making sure, and it's really not women's focus specifically, but we focus more around making sure our patients, when they leave this hospital, that they are connected to a primary care provider, that they can get access to their medications, that if they have social determinants, we get them connected to outside resources. So when we say social determinants, I mean things such as housing, lack of housing, lack of transportation, food insecurity, those kinds of things. So we work, I have a team that focuses on that and making sure that people get connected to resources as they need them. And then we also are looking at Prince George's County, unfortunately, is a high human traffic area. Mm-hmm. One of the new things that we're about to embark upon is thinking through how we might train and prepare our staff to be able to identify and screen these individuals early so that, you know, you can turn a tide. Unfortunately, a lot of young women who are human trafficked sometimes find themselves in the criminal justice system.
Yeah.
So it's really, you know, having no way out, feeling like they can't tell people certain things, and then, you know, they end up somewhere where they never intended to be.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. They never thought they would be there. Mm-hmm. Dr. Little, you have given us so much great information today. If somebody's watching right now and they want to know, like, hey, where can I get even more information, or how can I learn more about the new facility in Largo, where can they get those details at?
So visit our website, umcapitalregion.org. We're on Twitter, we're on Facebook, we're on Instagram, right? So you can always do those things. If you're specifically interested in women's health services, if you go to our website, you can go to our pages and you can drill down and find out all the things I talked about today. You can get more specifics, telephone numbers, and how to contact people. I think my number is on the website. If you want to reach out and call me, I'm happy to have conversations with people and help you get connected to care that you need. That's what we're here for. So we are looking forward to hearing from you.
Yes, definitely. Reach out if you are watching right now and you're like, hey, I need some more information, or I need to get connected with somebody. The resources are here. They're available. You just have to take that first step to reach out to somebody so mm-hmm. that the wealth of information and resources that are out here can come falling in your lap. Dr. Stacy Little, thank you so much. If you could leave our viewers with one last thought, what would you leave them with?
I would say be your best advocate for your health and the health of your children and your family and your community. We cannot sit back and wait for people to answer our problems. We need to say, these are the things we need. I expect the following. I need these questions answered. And that's what you should expect from your healthcare provider. And so I really want people to feel empowered to take control of their health in ways that perhaps they never have before. And think of your health provider as your partner in your best health, because that's how you get to that next level. And no one is saying you have to be model thin or without any chronic diseases, but it's how we get you to where you will be your best self and your best health in this moment in time in your life. And hopefully as you grow older, you know, you can delay chronic diseases and delay the onset of things that could impact your life and impair your quality of life.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well said, Dr. Little. Thank you again so, so very much. A lot of great information was shared today. I hope somebody was able to take something away. And I hope and I pray that the floodgates will just come rushing into the hospital so that we can do better as Black women. When it comes to our health. DMV, thank you for tuning in. This has been another episode, another edition of Girl Talk Live with your girl, Jackie Page. Have a great day.